If people would have heeded the words of the wise and the warnings to prepare ahead of time, we wouldn't be in such bad shape at this time. But here we are, so we have to deal with the situation that we're dealt. Now, I would say that all places of worship, of whatever denomination, whatever religion, whatever, all over the world, should go into 24-hour vigil at this time. In other words, keep the place of worship open 24 hours a day. So, and then people can come there at any time and enter into the mood of repentance. That is actually what's necessary. If that happens, then something amazing will take place. And I can explain how amazing it really is in this video, okay? I had a dream last night, extraordinary dream. And it's unmistakable what the dream is all about. It's very unmistakable. Was sitting in the bedroom, and I looked over. I sort of turned my head, and I said, "Bear, time to wake up." And there was this gigantic, or not gigantic, but I mean just a huge black bear sitting on its hind end there. And as soon as I said, "Bear, it's time to wake up," the bear opened its eyes. Imagine that. And I said, "Okay, let's go." And then I said, "Bear," immediately got up simultaneously with what I was thinking. And the bear walked in, and to the hallway, and I was going to open the door to the outside. And the bear walked through the kitchen into the living room, then out the door to the backyard. And then I saw it was like moving hay around in the backyard. So, unusual dream. Well, if you know what the bear symbolized, it's an amazing dream, because the bear is a play on beer, the being, the beer, B-E-A-R, the inner beer, the one that is being, that is the bear, the beer. And what is most important, anyone who really goes into the mood of repentance is going right directly towards this realization that I'll share right now. And this is the staggering one. This is the one that will stagger anybody. But in preparing for it, you're able to handle it. And the dream, I handled it perfectly. So it was a very good sign. The fact is that the bear, within us, you see, we have dwelling within us is the being, the beer, the one who's aware of being. This beer, or this bear, the inner bear, has never been asleep. That's right, has never been asleep. And that's the shocker. Because what we have done is we have told the bear, go to sleep. Go to sleep. Why? Because our desire is to be reminded of something greater than reality. And this world here, external, is what we believe is the reminder of something greater than reality. And the bear within, of course, will remind us of what? Reality, of being, of pure spaciousness. So we say, "Bear, you need to go to sleep, because I don't want you reminding me of reality, because I'm on this glorious quest to be reminded of something greater than reality." So we say, tell the bear, go to sleep, go to sleep, go to sleep, go to sleep. I remember fighting against the world when I came into the world, and the world was telling me overwhelmingly, "Hey, put your bear to sleep, put your bear to sleep. Put your being, awareness of being, to sleep." And I fought against it for about 12 years and finally succumbed. And I said, "Bear, you know, you got to go to sleep. You must be a sleeping bear." Now, what is the staggering realization is that all that the bear did, the beer did, the being, the inner, the being within us, the bear within us, it didn't go to sleep. All it did was close its eyelids. That's all it did. It only pretended to be asleep. Only pretended. It's been awake the entire time. And yeah, every time we look at the bear, you know, we say, okay, the bear's sleeping. Great. Okay, it's still sleeping? Is it still sleeping? Yeah. And if we think, uh-oh, maybe this will wake up the bear, we frantically say, how do I get the bear back to sleep? So you may listen to this video, and then afterwards you get all jittery. And you may, you know, go listen to some music. I gotta listen to some music and put that bear back to sleep. So, what the mood of repentance does is move us towards this realization that there is no awakening. There is no enlightenment. There is no awakening because the bear was never asleep. We were never unenlightened, actually. We just thought we were. Bear was just pretending. Now, why does the bear pretend? Because it knows our situation. And it knows if it doesn't pretend to be asleep, then we will actually get even more frightened and demand greater pretense from it, and greater and greater and greater. It knows this. Because of the fear of the continuity issue, we're not willing to be reminded of reality. We want to continue on with this external nightmare, thinking that this is reminding us of something greater than reality, prior to reality. So the bear pretends to be asleep, but it never was asleep. It always was aware. Always was aware. It just closes its eyelids, is all. And, you know, puts on this pretense like it's sound asleep. Being cannot go to sleep, actually. So repentance means this, to realize I never had to suffer at all. I never had to suffer at all. I never needed to suffer one bit. And the inner being was never asleep. Was never asleep. So repentance is a happy thing, but it's also a staggering, shocking thing. Because you think, oh my gosh, my whole lifetime I was under the assumption the bear was asleep. And it never, and now I realize it never was asleep. And it's like, wow, you know, what? So the whole issue of the spiritual path is to get to the point of where you can accept the fact that the bear was never asleep. And in the dream, I did, you know, it didn't cause me the slightest problem. Wasn't scared of the bear. No, the bear is actually incredibly good-natured, kind, friendly, very humorous, perfectly good-natured, not the slightest bit threatening, not the slightest bit. So, but it's this enormous bear, you know, it's just very big, powerful bear, but totally relaxed. So our being within is so profound and powerful. And heavy, it's the guru within. The guru means, you know, the heaviness, as it were, the spelling. So we have this huge guru within us. Everybody does. Everybody does. And it's always been awake. Now, the only thing about this is, in realizing this, I said, oh my gosh, that means I really can't hate anybody anymore. You know, there's all these people in the media, you just want to just like, God, just loathe them, you know, they're just so loathsome. But you can't really hate them because they have the same inner bear themselves that just is pretending to sleep. And they're just doing everything they can to convince themselves that the bear's asleep. That's what all they're doing. Everybody in the world, that's all they're doing. So you really can't hate anybody because they all have the same bear, you know. And this bear is so wonderful. How can you hate anyone? So that's, you know, that's like, wow. I say, oh well, you know, well. Because some people, you know, something very annoying. It's so annoying. You're just tired of these media people and the same old song and dance over and over and over. It's just so. God, it's like nails on a chalkboard. But let them, you know, let them come to the realization. They have to come to the realization, and so they will be helped indirectly in some way at some point to recognize that their inner being never went to sleep. Never went to sleep. And this reminds us of reality. This inner being reminds us of reality. It knows how to do that. So I would suggest that all places of worship around the world keep their doors open 24/7 at this point, because the world is in such a staggering crisis that if those who don't repent, and repent means to recognize that this inner being never went to sleep, it still is wide awake, and then to accept its wide awakeness within. In other words, I turned to the bear and I said, it's time to wake up. And the bear opened its eyes. Okay, so so I was aware that the bear was awake. So even though we might say intellectually, well, okay, I know the bear is not sleeping, but we're not willing to actually see that it's awake. We have to actually accept that it's awake, and then it starts moving. Now, these people wonder, how come God doesn't help us in the world? We see the typhoon and Tacloban and Philippines, and we say, why, how come it's, what's going on? If the bear started to take action, let's say healing action, okay, we would know that the bear is awake, that the being is awake, wouldn't we? And we don't want the being to wake. We want to believe the being is asleep, because we think that this being, well, it's true, it will remind us of reality profoundly, to the point where we're going to drop perception altogether for knowing. And we think that that is an attack upon us, that somehow God is trying to rob us, dispossess us of something greater than reality, greater than creation. So we would be furious at such a thing. So we insist that the healing take place in a way that doesn't involve the being. We insist upon it. That is why you see what the stuff that happens in the world, the tragedies, etc., etc. You see why people struggle so mightily, because they keep the being out of it. Say, being, you're sound asleep, you can't do anything. You're in a coma. But in this dream, the bear was moving about throughout the house and moving about the yard, and it was fully alive and fully active, and I was thrilled. I said, that's great. That's unusual. So the bear can heal me. I say, hey, bear, start with me. I mean, other people don't want to be healed through the being. They want the drugs, they want the hospital, they want the surgeries, they want the witch doctors, you know, they want the shamans, they want all the song and dance, but they don't want the being to be involved. They want to keep the being out of it. That's why the suffering is the way that it is in the world. I said, we don't have to suffer at all. The being can take care of us. But we insist, being, stay in your coma. Now, the being does help us subtly. But it has to be very careful that we don't connect the dots and think that it's helping us. So that's why all this, you know, calamities befall us, actually. The being can actually keep the body in immaculate condition and totally functional, etc., etc., if we allow it. But very, very few allow that, because that would, you know, that's a very awake, it's a being that one would realize is very awake within, and we feel extremely threatened by that. So most people pray to God in such a way that's backwards. They say, God, please help me keep that being asleep. That's what they pray for, really. But it's really praying to the ego. And then they try to get tricky with it. Say, like, for instance, Jesus, you're the only one who had the being within you. None of us have it within us. You had it within you. You're the only one. And they keep trying to tell themselves this. So what they're really saying is, I don't have the beer within me, or the beer within me is in a permanent coma. Only Jesus is the one that has the beer, but not me, not us. So that reassures them that they can still pursue this effort to remind themselves of what never was, something, you know, greater than reality. They can keep pursuing it. So very, you know, these idols can be made of religion, of saints, of saviors, etc., and even of God. That people can use them to, you know, to try and, you know, appeal to them. Say, please keep the beer within asleep. I'm terrified it might wake up. That's the majority of what the world is focused on, is they're terrified that this beer might wake up, and they imagine all sorts of fantasies to try to motivate themselves. Like, oh, the beer is going to go on a rampage. Beer is going to tear me limb to limb, or rape me terribly, or kill me, or destroy the house, or do all this stuff. You know, they tell themselves these fantasies to keep motivating themselves. So they keep saying, beer, you know, this beer, you've got to stay totally asleep, and you're not even there. I'm going to block you out entirely. I'm going to be completely focused on this world, which is supposedly reminding me of something greater than everything, greater than reality. That's a fact. So those who continue down that road are the ones who do not repent, who don't get to the point of saying, ah, bear, time to wake up. Wake up, bear. And then they realize, oh my gosh, you were just pretending to be asleep, weren't you? And the bear just smiled and said, you're just pretending, you're never asleep. You never sleep. How did I realize that? Because the bear opened its eyes simultaneously with my thought of wake up, bear. And there was no grogginess in the bear. The bear opened its eyes, and the bear was purely, perfectly alert and awake and alive. There was zero evidence of it ever having been asleep. None. It was completely limber, you know. If you're in a deep coma and been sleeping a long time, that's not how you wake up. There's no way. So I noticed that, and I said, hey, bear, I don't think you were really ever asleep, were you? So, this is the heart and soul of our goal, the heart and soul of our goal. And you can call it anything you want. Doesn't matter. Be more pragmatic than that and just say, hey, you know, what's the dynamic? The bear was never asleep. I just told the bear to pretend to be dead, you know. So a lot of people want the bear to be dead. They say, bear, play dead. Play dead. I want you to play dead. So the bear plays dead. And then maybe later on they say, bear, be asleep. You don't need to be dead, but just asleep. And then you work through it more and more and more, and finally you say, bear, wake up. The whole time, though, the bear is totally awake the entire time. So a lot of people in the world are saying, bear, disappear. Disappear. Be a disappearing bear. And so maybe the bear pretends to not be there, but it's still there. But they're like looking, say, I don't see the bear. Where's the bear? It's hiding. You know, the bear like hides somewhere or something. It's still there. So you have people in the world who say, there's no bear there. I don't see any bear. No bear. And others, then they say, bear, I can. You're there, but I want you to be dead. And they say, okay, the bear's there, but it's dead. And then there are others who say, okay, bear, be asleep. And the bear's there, but you say, well, the bear, sure, it's there, but it's sleeping. Or bear be in a coma, and then bear be asleep. And then finally you get to the point where you say, bear, wake up. So that kind of paints a picture of the stratification of belief in the world, doesn't it? You have those who say, God, beings, what are you talking about? There's no such thing. We're just this body. That's it. and nothing else. What are you talking? You're crazy. You're talking about anything else. You're totally crazy. Nuts. You need to be institutionalized. We need to have a worldwide campaign to institutionalize anybody who ever even mentions God. You know, those are the people who say, bear, disappear. Okay. And then there. We killed the bear. The bear came here, but we killed it. So there's the other one saying, bear, be dead. Be dead. Play dead, bear. You're dead. The bear plays, pretends to be dead. And they're the ones saying, ah, nah, you know, we're focused on this world and how wonderful it is and how wonderful it can be. In other words, we're focused on trying to remember what it was like to be greater than God, even though we never were. So, and then the other group is those who are earnestly trying to, on the spiritual path, on the path of repentance, saying, bear, be asleep, be asleep. Be asleep. That's stratified into two areas. Like one bear, be in a coma, please. Be in a coma. Be in a coma. Those are the ones that are really, they're moving away from bear, be dead. They say, okay, bear, I don't want you to be dead, but in a coma. Okay. So you know, you can tell those people where they're kind of, you know, they're kind of changing over from bear, be dead to bear, be coma. And they're not quite as insistent, you know, we killed the bear. We killed the bear's dead. They're not. And then after a while, they say, okay, bear, I don't need you in a coma, but I need you to be asleep. Bear, be asleep. Then those are the ones who have a more open mind, who are able to actually use inquiry. Okay, up until that point, you really can't use inquiry. It's a more slow, cumbersome type of thing, really. Once you get to bear, be asleep, you can use inquiry. And you say, why is the bear here? Why is it sleeping? What caused it to go to sleep? You know, why am I this? You start asking all these questions and just looking and thinking and saying, huh? And there's something, you know, that isn't quite right. I want to know what that is, you know, and all this stuff. How come the bear's not, how come God's not helping me? You know, what is the answer? Start really asking questions. And you say, you know, that's bear, be asleep. And then finally the end of inquiry is when you finally say, bear, be awake. And that's, then the bear opens his eyes and starts moving about. Now, what's this hay thing that bear was involved with, all this hay, moving all this hay, making hay, which means getting the job done, the harvest, you know, it's the harvest, right? You're making hay before, when all the sun shines, meaning harvest the crop before winter. Well, the opportunity is there, get it done now. So the bear immediately went to work on that. So, you know, what's going to happen? I don't know. But like I've said, all sorts of stuff for me is happening along these lines. Now, why is it happening to me? Why am I here, etc.? Well, it's interesting to note, in a life previous to this one, I actually put out an enormous amount of material into the public eye. Enormous amount. And was very well received in it. So I have familiarity with, you know, putting out real high quality information into the public eye. So I maybe there's something within that said, hey, would you do this? And I said, sure, I can do that. I'll put this out into the public, even though it's like the really kind of highest sort of teachings here, actually, that normally are not put out in the public like this, just for anybody to look at. But I said, you know, it's a crisis. Let's just put all this information out, because of course people who are in the bear, you don't exist, disappear mode, be invisible bear, they say completely crazy. What do you know? Those who say bear be dead are also like, ah, you know, shut up. Those who say bear be in a coma are also nervous, frighten me. Those who are bear be asleep, they say, I kind of see what you're saying. I kind of see like that. And then the ones who are close to, you know, reaching the goal of bear, be awake, they're like, you know, bells are ringing. Yeah, they might be quiet, just like, wow, whoa. Yeah. Yeah, so, the bear is not going to wake up. It's not open its eyes and start moving until you have lost your fear of it, because it'll do exactly what you say. You say, bear, pretend to, you know, bear, I want you to be asleep. It will pretend to be asleep. So there's no worry in that regard. I've never felt the bear doing anything for me, okay? The inner being, I've never felt it because I was still saying, bear, stay asleep. You know, I want you to be asleep. So I've never been aware, really, other than very subtle, vague kind of things, you know. It's just I say, maybe, maybe not, I don't know. But as far as, well, there have been a lot of little things, but little stuff, you know. But I just, you can't, you say, well, maybe, maybe not. But as far as like something, you know, like a healing or something is really obviously the being is simply, you know, the being is doing this. No, there's been nothing. There's been nothing like that. Nothing that really hits home too close, you know. This seems to be kind of at a distance type of thing. Some stuff you think, well, I bet you, it feels like the Holy Spirit was involved in this. The beingness was involved in this. But I don't know. Maybe, maybe not. So don't worry about it. You're not going to get overwhelmed at all. The being is not going to drop its pretense of sleep until you tell it to, until you say, hey, I'm ready. Bear, wake up. You know, if you were in a room in your bedroom and you looked over and you saw this massive black bear there, you know, just sitting there, with his eyes closed, right next to you in your room, most people would like completely freak out, wouldn't they? It'd just be completely shocking, you know. Oh my God, there's a bear in my room. Ah, out the window, you know. Go out the door. It would just completely panic most people. But in my dream, I turned to the bear and there was no fear, panic, or nervousness, nothing. I just said, hey bear, time to wake up. And it's like, oh, sure, there's a bear in my room. But you look at it, it's kind of funny because most people, again, if you turn, there's a bear in your room, you wouldn't just say, oh, of course there's a bear in my room. It doesn't work like that, does it? So when I say get into the mood of repentance, it's really aimed towards this. And the realization that the bear's always been awake. I didn't have to suffer at all. I've never needed to suffer at all. That is like the feeling like, wow, I can drop my suffering and I never needed to suffer at all. It's a very solemn kind of thing. Like, my gosh, I've spent my whole life with this inner being telling it to be non-functional and sleep, and I've been suffering like I'm lonely, I'm separated, I'm isolated, I'm embattled and all this stuff. It was all untrue. The bear was never asleep. It was like, oh my gosh. It kind of brings, you know, some sadness and some regret and a constellation of feelings, you know. It's just like, so, it's so much. The feelings are so much. It just feels like a kind of a heaviness, a solemn heaviness. That's the mood of repentance. That's why I say people should go to places of worship, and the places of worship now should completely focus on supporting this mood of repentance. I was in church Sunday, and unfortunately, I have to say, it did not support this mood of repentance at all. It was Catholic Mass, and the priest started out with a joke about the local football team losing, you know, and everybody's laughing, and jocularity, starts off with jocularity, and then some, you know, one of the singers did some bravura performance, and the congregation actually clapped. First time it's ever happened for just one of the songs. You're not supposed to clap. This is not a concert. You're not supposed to clap. And there's all sorts of stuff that happened. It was just like, I said, wow, this is not at all supporting the mood of repentance at all. I didn't feel the slightest support for the mood of repentance there in that Catholic Mass. I'm telling you, that's a fact. So we're not, the places, you know, the places of worship have got to support the mood of repentance, I'm telling you. Or else they're not, and Jesus will say, I don't know you. You know, Jesus is just a term for the one who completely said, bear, you're awake. I know, and you've always been awake. And let's move and let's help out others accept this fact too. Okay, historically, Jesus the Christ. So, you know, that inner being, this whole effort to help of humanity, which extends from throughout all traditions, actually, all traditions, okay? Many have realized that the bear has never been asleep from all sorts of traditions. So that's why I say all places of worship around the planet should now, again, be open 24/7 and be in support of this mood of repentance. The ashrams should be open, you know, the temples, the synagogues, the mosques, the churches, the chapels, the meditation centers, the healing centers, the retreats, the tabernacle, whatever you want, I don't know, all the names of places, whatever you want to call a place of worship around the world, should 24/7, and now everything's to be in support of this mood of repentance. If you really want to help the world, if you want to help during this crisis, because anything short of that is not going to help. The crisis is so severe that anything short of that is not going to help. That's like saying, you know, the people in Tacloban, hey people, let's all go to this church or, you know, this place that's built with rebar and strong tie hardware, and the roof is anchored with strong tie, and the whole thing is built to withstand this ferocious monster. And you say, people, your houses are not built to withstand this. You got to relocate to this church, okay? This building that is built to withstand it. And then the people say, okay, that's a good idea. And some of them go, some don't. They say, no, we've been through typhoons before. No problem. We can handle this. And no, because the situation now in this world, this crisis is way more severe than what we've ever gone through on this planet. It is the worst crisis ever, which Jesus pointed out to us. It said the end of this particular age will be the worst ending of a cycle ever. And it's so bad, you know, that it just... He said, if it weren't for some intervention, all life on the planet would be lost. That's how bad it's supposedly going to be. So, you better get into a situation that will enable you to that can handle the storm, okay? So, what that means is get into the mood of repentance. Now, you can do it at your place, etc., wherever you are. But a lot of times people are so nervous about the bear waking up, or the bear say, I've got a bear in my room. they like to be around other people, to go to congregation, to go place of worship, and that supports their mood of repentance. They feel some support there. So 24/7 mood of repentance, and maybe there'll be some great bears will come to those places and help with this mood of repentance. That's possible. There may be some those in the world who have realized and accepted that that the being has never been asleep, who are able to actually go to those places where people congregate entering into the mood of repentance, and actually, you know, bless them and say, hey, you know, it's okay, you can do it, and encourage them. It's possible. Because, you know, realizing that we don't need to wake up because we've never been asleep. In other words, our being doesn't need to wake up because it's never been asleep. Realizing that is a very tough thing to do. It's very difficult to get to that. But the way is to enter into this mood of repentance. It is the way. Is to actually feel this kind of like this deep remorse. Again, it's more than any particular feeling. It's kind of a heaviness. And going through this, I felt like, you know, like, wow, afterwards I feel so tired. Almost like I'm dead, you know, just so tired. It's such a strain. It is a strain. The spiritual path is a great strain, actually. And those who are pretending that the bear is invisible, disappear bear, you know, they're out cavorting around, okay? Those are the ones who are cavorting around in the world. And I say, what's the matter with you, poor killjoys, you know? you don't want to have fun. What's the matter with you? You don't want to have fun. We don't, you know, here we're all kind of somber and solemn, and because we're feeling the weight of this repentance. I said, oh my God, I've been in, how long have I been in this situation thinking that I had no being within me, you know, that was awake? So long, so much suffering, so terrible, and it was all unnecessary. You know, that's a shocking revelation. You don't feel like cavorting around this world, no way. So those who want the bear to be, you know, invisible are cavorting around and saying, yeah, come on, have fun, everybody, have fun. What's the matter with you stupid religious people, you know? You guys are crazy. Why are you not having enough fun? Come on, party, let's party, party, party. Let's have fun. Mardi Gras all the time, you know. And we say, no, not interested. They say, come on, have a drink. Ah, life is short, live it up, they say. No. Yeah, so. And so my life's a case in point where I basically just sat at home my whole life working on this issue. That's, you know, it's very important. So definitely I didn't have much fun. I tried to a few times, but it didn't really, you know. I said, well, what a waste of time. This isn't it. Because you see, the whole world is just so obsessed with having fun, you think, wow, I'm being left behind. And I remember going to a movie I tried to go one more movie in a movie theater, and I said, I can't watch this, we gotta go. And we just left. I said, I can't take it, no way. This is not gonna be my life. I'm not gonna spend my life in a movie theater. So that's the wheat and the tares, the difference between the wheat and the tares, the sheep and the goats. The goats are prancing around, munching on everything. Hey, look at this, let's have fun, let's have fun. Until daddy takes the T-bird away. And the others are saying, hey, I got this heavy burden. You know, I'm really under this heavy, heavy burden. Like, wow, I feel like I did something. Initially, for a while, we feel guilty. Because like we feel, oh, I did something terrible. I killed the bear. Or I made the deer disappear. I killed the bear. Or I put the bear into a coma. And you feel this terrible guilt. Now, for me, I did have the terrible guilt for a while. But I got past it to the point where I didn't really feel, you know, hardly any guilt at all. It's been a long time since I've felt much guilt. Because I got to the point where I saw the bear is just asleep. So I didn't feel like I killed the bear or put the bear into a coma or made it vanish or something. I said, no, the bear's there, but it's sleeping. So you don't feel so guilty then. So the guilt, if you're going through guilt, it does ease up as you keep working on this mood, enter into the mood of repentance. It does ease up. It eases up, which is a great thing, because that guilt, I know, can be absolutely terrible. I remember going through that in, I think, high school. Starting in high school, I went into, you know, severe depression because I felt like I killed the bear. Because everybody insisted on it. They said, hey, if you want to party with us, you can't have a bear that's alive. You got to kill the bear. You know, our bear's dead. And I said, wow, you know, and just, this is what I have to do, you know. And it was just like, I felt so horrible about even thinking about something like that. So there's various phases that one goes through with various attending feelings, you know, where some have crippling guilt for a while. But then gradually they say, well, maybe the bear's not dead, maybe it's in a coma, because I think I see a little bit of motion, that, oh, it's in a coma. And I say, great, you know, it's so, like, such a relief to say, oh, it's not dead, it's in a coma. Then you think, oh, I put it in a coma, that's terrible. And you say, well, maybe I can help, you know, the bear a little bit. Maybe I can, at least I can take care of it and make it feel comfortable, you know, that kind of feeling. Like, and then you get the sense that maybe it's not in a coma, and maybe it's only in a deep sleep. And then you say, well, maybe it's not in a deep sleep, maybe it's just resting a nice sleep. And then you get less and less feeling of badness about yourself. And then finally you say, bear, you're awake. And then next, it's like, you were never asleep, you were never dead, never in a coma, any of that stuff. So, that's the spiritual path. And it is not easy. Not easy. Now, we're in this world crisis, a spiritual crisis. The world crisis is both it's a spiritual crisis within, and it's an external crisis, a projected without. Because when people in this world want the bear to disappear, when they want the bear to be dead, the inner being to be dead. So you'll have a spirit-killing culture, which is what we have now. I was watching the 49ers football game, a little bit of it, and the commercials that came on were so terrible, so loathsome, so designed to be spirit-killing. Basically, all said, spirit, be dead. You're dead. We're killing you. You know, it is just so terrible. I said, the game's completely unwatchable. It was unwatchable anyway, but the commercials, I can't watch television like that because the commercials are truly horrific. They're for PlayStation this and games, video games. They're using the kids' interest in a game, recreational, which young people are interested in that just naturally, a lot of people. And then they get your attention focused, pulled into that game, and then they hit you with this extreme violence and stuff and try to get you into, all this incredibly vicious stuff. That's an expression, in the external expression of an inner desire that the bear be dead, inner being be dead, okay? And then we have atheists opening up churches all over and saying, it's expression of the inner desire for the bear to disappear. Disappear. Not like bear. There's no bear anywhere. Never has been. Anyone who thinks that there was ever a bear here is delusional. And that's gaining so much traction throughout the world now. And we'll gain more and more and more as the culture gets pulled down. Now, why am I doing what I'm doing, and why am I encouraging you to get into the mood of repentance? I'll tell you why. Because anything less would be uncivilized. And that's a fact. It would be extremely uncivilized not to do this. All right. And we cannot throw out civilization entirely, which is what the world is actually suggesting. As it slides down, civilization dies, there's all these, they put all these decorations on it. But that's what they really want, and no. I'm pro civilization, okay. So I, if this was left unattended, it would be uncivilized. It would be an uncivilized situation for sure. So you have to have this apex teaching. You have to have this type of teaching in the world that provides a civilizing effect on the planet, actually. So it's essential. And, if you really ask yourself, do you really want to live in a barbaric situation, or do you want to live in a civilized situation? That's really the choice we have. It's the choice between the wheat and the tares. The tares are these poisonous, noxious weeds who want just a barbaric, hedonistic, anti-Christ, anti-bear, bear you're dead, bear you never existed, type of hell, really. And the other people say, no, a bear, you're just sleeping. They want civilization. And you don't have civilization unless you have institutions and teachers and people who say, bear, you're awake. You don't have civilization. Not real civilization. So civilization is actually founded upon the realization that, bear, you're awake and you never were asleep. It's founded upon that. Without that, you don't have civilization. Because then people have a common goal, and they're willing to build a civilization that's civil, truly civil, not this PC stuff that we have, which is really tyrannical. Now, truly civil, a true civilization, which says, folks, we're going to remain focused on the goal, and all this other fun stuff, forget it. That's hedonistic paganism. We're not interested in that. That's just tribalism. That's not civilization. Civilizations, again, the cornerstone of civilization comes from the realization that the beer within has never been asleep, has never been in a coma, has never been dead, has never disappeared. It's always been there, perfectly awake. And that this inner being reminds us of reality, has a way to remind us of reality, reminds us of reality. And then we're able to give up this totally fanciful whim of trying to be reminded of something greater than reality, which there is no such thing. So it's just this complete meaningless farce, actually, all this external stuff that's taking place, just meaningless farce. We become willing to just let go of that, say it's not needed anymore. That's the goal of civilization. Civilization's goal is to make itself ultimately unnecessary as we transcend civilization altogether in the setting down of all perception. But that's a step that we don't have to concern ourselves with, because that God takes that step for us finally. But now we need to reconcile ourselves with the fact that the inner being has never been asleep. It's always been awake. And then to allow this awakeness within us to see the bear moving around in our yard and house and say, "Hey bear, how good morning bear, so happy to see you, it's great." And let it do its thing. It knows how to function. So, you know, we have to, if we truly value civilization, which I most certainly do, we have to attend to this. It's in like the Buddhist tradition, it's called apex teaching or radical Dzogchen, which you have to get to that. You know, it's no longer, hey, how do you wake the bear up? You know, most spiritual teaching in all traditions seems to sound like, hey, we got to wake the bear up. We got to wake the inner being. We got to activate it. We got to realize it. We got to, you know, and that's fine for a while as a phase, but ultimately you get to the phase where you realize the bear was never asleep. And that's different. It's a different phase. And so we got to get to that phase now. We have to talk about it. If we left it untalked about it, it would be uncivilized to not talk about it, actually. And to not watch these videos would be uncivilized. So really, it's this struggle within you to say, you know what, I really do want civilization. Not some homogenized, the bear is dead, you know, barbaric kingdom or something. Not some new world order where everyone agrees, hey, we all believe the same, so we're happy now. Yeah, we all believe the bear is dead, so we can now get on with indulging in our remembrances of something greater in reality, which, of course, is this terrible realm of impermanence that doesn't remind us of anything except suffering. And ultimately, chaos, actually. It's how we symbolize that which is greater than reality, total chaos. Mutual exclusives, total chaos, you know. But that's not civilization. No way. So the question is, are we more civilized now than before? The answer is no, absolutely not. We're more homogenized. But is homogenization civilization? But what are we homogenized around, you know? We're homogenized around the bear is dead theme. And it's going down to the bear never existed theme. Right? It's going there very fast. So if you say, hey, the bear is alive, it's functioning in my life, and they'll say, you're completely insane. Dangerously insane, you need to be incarcerated, you know, and treated with lobotomy or something. So again, it's a spiritual crisis in the world right now. And we are told that at the end of this age, there will be a parting of the ways between the wheat and the tares, between the sheep and the goats. There'll be a parting of the ways. See, the sheep go where the shepherd tells them to go. And the shepherd says, here, sheep, here's your pasture. graze on this pasture. And the sheep say, okay. And they graze on that pasture. The goats want to just take off and just go everywhere. Rummage around in garbage cans, you know, jumping here, jumping there, very mischievous into everything, indulging in everything they can eat, you know, eat this, I want to eat that. Whereas the sheep, the shepherd says, sheep, here's your really good grass right here. Just right here, you stay here and you eat the grass, and that's what the sheep do. So the sheep are the civilized ones, the people of civilization who say, let's go to our place of worship, let's enter into the mood of repentance, that's what the good shepherd has told us, and let us eat of this food, and let's graze there. Whereas the goats are saying, we don't need any of that. Hey, let's go party, you know, I want to go here, jump here, and then, wow, let's have this, you know, let's have some fun. Let's get into this, let's try this drug, oh, wow. And a new lifestyle, let's try that, you know, this, oh, let's try that, anything that's new, hey, let's try that, you know, that's the goat, those are the goats. And the goats look at the sheep and say, oh, you stupid sheep, you're grazing in the same place you've been grazing for so long, we're out here munching on these weeds over here, you know, now, those are the goats. And the goats are always saying, I need a new drug, you know, that kind of thing. So there will be a parting of the ways between the sheep and the goats. Those who have entered into a mood of repentance and those who spit on it, parting of the ways. Somehow that will take place. So I get up in the morning, say, what am I going to do? I say, hey, the goat says, hey, how about... Goats are saying, hey, how about go over to the beach? How about go here? How about go to the mountains? How about this? Hey. I say, no, I think I'm just going to stay at home and I'm going to tape and I'm going to enter into the mood of repentance. I'm going to stay focused and serious on this. And I think that's what I'm going to do. It's like that. Now, first it starts out reading a lot of books. Read books, spiritual books. And then you get better and better books. And then you find something that seems like the ultimate book. And then you start doing inquiry, where you're not even reading a book. You start being able to focus on your mental processes and then sorting it out. Like, is the bear really dead? You know, is the bear really dead? Is it really in a coma? And you go through this. And... eventually, you're actually able to say, hey, bear, wake up. So some people, you know, reading books is a good place to be. Wherever you are, that's a good place to be, as long as you are making this consideration. Say, wait a minute, I'm not quite comfortable with, you know, how I'm treating this bear, the inner being. I'm not comfortable with it. I feel like something's not right. So the pressure of civilization, fueled by, you know, all of the barbaric institutions of the planet, is to move us away from the mood of repentance, out into fun, have fun with the goats. And what we're saying is, no, let's triple our efforts towards entering into the mood of repentance. Let's have all the places of worship of the world decide to stay open 24/7. So we can have vigils, you know, there should be vigils around the world right now. And, you know, people go in and maybe stay for 4 hours, mood repentance, and someone else comes in 4 more hours, and then 4 more hours, and then 4, and then 4, and then 4. You know, around the clock, there should be someone in the place of worship, a group of people, or people, one person, group, whatever, entering into the mood of repentance and saying, bear, I'm trying to accept that you've never been asleep. I didn't do anything to you. I didn't harm you in the slightest bit. In fact, I could never harm you. I never needed to suffer. All the suffering was completely unnecessary. Entering into that heavy realization, like, wow. Around the clock, around the globe, 24/7. Maybe some places will start doing that. They should. Maybe you have a little chapel or something. You can do it. I would say, if you want to meet up with the, you know, the great gurus and saints, etc., who may actually be available in the world at this time, you need to be involved with that, most likely. They're not going to go to the goats. No, they're going to say, hey, is somebody holding a vigil? And, okay, I'm going to show up there. And they're going to support that effort. And so we have to get ready for this parting of the ways situation. Obviously, the planet, the way it's going, is towards, you know, barbaric hedonism and this homogenization. The bear is dead, the bear doesn't even exist theme. And the momentum towards that is just unstoppable. There's no brakes. So obviously, if you don't want to go there, you're going to have to decide, I've got to go the other direction. Otherwise, I'm going to, you know, it's one, you know, the train's leaving the platform. You can't have one foot on the train and one foot on the platform forever. It's not possible. So people will have to decide. And so that has to be encouraged. You know, you might say, hey, I really want to see some great saint. Well, maybe if you go to this, you know, vigil, maybe the great saint will show up there. That type of thing. But even if they don't, even if none of that happens, that doesn't matter. The point is, you have to actually do this, get after it. And you can have a vigil in your own house. I'm just saying, as a collective civilization, planetary civilization, that's what a civilization should be doing at this point. If we claim that we're civilized, that's what should actually be taking place. Otherwise, you can't make any claims to being civilized, cannot. Places that are dedicated towards salvation, towards awakening, they should be responding. In a civilized world, those places need to be the places that take the lead. They have to take the lead. And if they refuse to take the lead, then, you know, what is that? It's a default. It's deciding to be uncivilized, go the way of, you know, to return to, you know, dust, the way of dust. So we'll see what happens next. Every day is like a wow type of thing, really. Yeah, it should be. At this point, every day should be like a wow type of situation. Because we're getting right down to it now. Really, the countdown is there. So just get your sleep. I took a nap this evening of like an hour and a half. I was just completely zonked out. I tried the tape and I was so tired I couldn't even move my mouth. Because this is, you know, it's like a really profound situation, and it takes a lot out of you. It's so staggering and wow, shocking. It's my gosh, the bear was never asleep. I'm still in the mood of repentance. I'm still feeling this, like, my gosh, the whole time I was feeling so guilty and everything. It was all unnecessary. It was all a lie, you know. And I'm processing this, you know, that takes a lot of effort, a lot of energy, which is why there should be places that support this process, you know, open 24/7 right now, because we're in the apex of the world crisis. Now we're going into the extreme crisis mode. And this terrible typhoon in the Philippines, the worst storm that's ever struck land, as it were, you know, is another sign, actually. And I know, like, the Filipino community is devastated all over the world. The Filipinos all over the world, and they're really, you know, shook to the core over this. Many of them have family and relatives there, actually, and we wish them all the very best. But this is just another sign, like, hey, you know, things are getting extremely intense now. We've had many warnings of super intensity, worst case scenario kind of things. Now, fortunately, it didn't go through Manila, which would have really been worst case scenario. But, so, you know, but don't wait. We're entering into the ferocious times, and but the remedy is there for those who want it. Enter into the mood of repentance, and I'll keep doing what